Skipping the introductions again, you know, because it's our fifth session today. And thank you all for joining us for the second last session. And today, my session would be about invisible disabilities. So far, for the previous four sessions that you know, we were discussing about disabilities which are visible and how visibility of a disability adds to a stigma and how there are various parameters how a disability becomes visible in terms of the disability itself, also in terms of assistive devices which makes the disability visible. For example, a wheelchair or a white cane, or if somebody is using a hearing aid, or you know, a different kind of assistive devices that one would be using. So when we talk about invisible disabilities, there are no assistive devices there. And when I talk about the precariousness of our bodies, then we also need to talk about the precariousness of our minds. How even our mind, you know, could traverse from being abled, so-called abled, to being a disabled, right? So when we talk about being mentally disabled, or when we talk about, say, the invisible forms of disabilities, of which, you know, we would be discussing about in a while, then we also need to take into consideration that we are dealing with the invisibility of that, right? So it's very hidden. It's sometimes, you know, when we talk about things like depression, when we talk about things like anxiety, you would not know the person next to you, sitting next to you, could be dealing with certain issues like that. And in the last session, when I was talking about how COVID has, you know, brought so many changes in our lives and how, you know, the boundaries have basically become blurred, then let us also talk about how COVID has brought in this another element of mental health and how, you know, we are all dealing with mental health issues on daily basis. And COVID has basically, you know, intensified. Now, when I talk about how COVID has intensified all these, you know, issues for us, can you just give me certain examples of the mental health issues that you can think of? Anyone, if anyone is dealing with you know, certain things like, you know, if maybe we can talk about that. Anyone, any examples here? How, you know, you feel your, the way you were thinking, the way you were behaving, you know, in the pre-COVID time and in the post-COVID time, how it has changed. So this new normal, the so-called new normal that we talk about, what is it? And is it something different? Are your, you know, do you feel your mind is behaving something differently? Anyone, any experiences that you would like to share? You can unmute yourself and maybe, you know, you can discuss. Yes, Somnath.
So there was this sense of hopelessness and despair that I felt very heavily during the first wave, although it eventually passed away. But yes, that was very intense at that point of time.
So did you ever feel like that before? Or was it, you know, the fact that we all were sitting at home and, you know, we were working from home. A lot of us lost our jobs also. So that added to it. Lot of us lost our relatives. That added to it. So was it like, did you feel this kind of feeling before COVID or was it after, post-COVID?
Before COVID, the feeling hopelessness would be there, but it was not due to the factors that were there during COVID, right? And during COVID, the hopelessness actually made me question certain things about certain systems, about religion and the idea of God itself.
Right. So certain moments in a life could come when, you know, we would traverse these boundaries, right? So when we call somebody mentally unstable, when we call somebody mentally disabled, when we call somebody dealing with depression, or, you know, we look down upon somebody, you know, due to these issues, then we also need to understand that maybe someday we could also traverse that boundary. And these boundaries make us very vulnerable. You know, this adds to our vulnerability. This adds to the frailty. This adds to the debility that we were discussing in the last session also. So here, when we're looking at invisible disabilities, we are basically looking at the neurodiversity of our minds and how our minds could behave, you know, differently, and whether, you know, we would see a mental disability as a disability, or we would see it as some sort of diversity, is something that, you know, we can explore, and something, you know, that we as disability, you know, students, disability studies students, should, you know, reread a lot of texts. We need to reread a lot of films that, you know, we have never discussed before through the lens of disability studies, looking at various mental health issues, looking at various hidden invisible disabilities that kept lingering throughout the films, and nobody spoke about that. So let us look into these films. First of all, let me start with my PPT, and I am going to share it here. So can you see the PPT? Harmendra?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
You can play it on full screen also.
I'm just how to do that.
Right side mein jo niche hai na.
Yeah. I think this is what. Haan. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So the topic of my session is on invisible disabilities. This is day 5. And let us look at disabilities which are not visible. Not every disability is visible, and there are disabilities around us, people sitting next to us, people, you know, who we always speak with. You know, we might not notice that they are dealing with certain issues, that they are dealing with certain mental health issues. So let us talk about these hidden, invisible kind of disabilities, which we would need to identify, and we would need to talk about them. So the earliest examples of feeble-mindedness in India, if we talk about, and this is something that Shilpa Anand, in one of her essays, she talks about Chahadola's Chuhas. And I would read it out from here. And a few of you were asking on the chat group that, you know, about the books and the readings. Actually, the few readings which I was not able to share, they are in my book. And I was not able to get them scanned, since the books are not, you know, they are not opening properly. So the books are pasted, and, you know, if I open my books, the pages are going to come out. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to locate if I can find ebooks for you. But if that is not possible, maybe I will click photos of, you know, the pages and send it across, you know, on the group. I think that would be okay, because these are some 5-6 essays from this book. This is called Disability Studies in India, Global Discourses, Local Realities. And I tried to find its ebook, but it's not there online. I'll share the pictures with you. Right. So Shilpa Anand, in one of her essays, she would write here about the earliest care and rehabilitation centers for mentally disabled in South Asia. And she talks about how, we cannot, when we talk about the Western models of disability, how, they are not appropriate to be used when we talk about mental disability in India. She gives you the earliest example of feeble-mindedness and how, she writes about it. I will read it from here. And she says that to illustrate further, let us take the second case of Shahadola's rats as in tuhas, and an instance commonly identified within the literature as an Indian form of feeble-mindedness. Colonial reports tell us of the presence of rat-like creatures at the shrine of Shahadola in the Punjab region in the 19th century. So this is actually a report from Punjab region, 1921. So the earliest examples could be, noted from that time. And this is actually when it started getting reported. Obviously these, when we talk about mental disability and we talk about people having mental disability, it always existed in our history and in our culture, but this was the earliest accounts where it got reported. The accounts, depending on the time period and disciplinary affiliation of the author, allow for the following disclosures. The collection of rat-like human beings at the shrine was due to the benevolence of the Muslim saint Shahadola, who was kind to animals. So the shrine was named as Shahadola's shrine, and why you would see these people who had basically, they were living with microcephalic, and this is actually a kind of the brain has a stunted kind of growth, and the heads, they become smaller. So you would find people with that kind of mental disability outside that shrine. Because Shahadola used to love animals. So these people were considered as rats. And therefore, people used to, send their relatives who basically looked like that to this shrine. Microcephalic boys collected at the shrine and begged for a living because their human abilities were limited. Note that this explanation classifies the erstwhile rat-like creatures under a medical diagnostic category, microcephaly. Chuhas who gathered at the shrine of Shahadola are evidence of an Indian or South Asian brand of feeble-mindedness. We note here that a medical category is now more specifically a psychiatric classification. Now, why I was reading this from here, because, when we talk about India, the way, you would look at mental disability or, the invisible kind of disabilities, earlier, they were never seen through this psychiatric or medical gaze. They were seen through a religious gaze. They were considered people of God. They were considered children of God, and they were treated like that. But the coming of, the colonial history that India went through, there was this change of narrative, and there was this, you see institutions like asylums coming in India. You see institutions where, these special schools came to India with the colonial history of India, which was never, you would not find that if you go back to the historical documents, you would not find that happening in India before the British came to India. So this idea of institutionalization, this idea of, bringing in psychiatry, bringing in medical diagnostics, all this came with the British colonial history in India. Now, when we talk about, the idea of how mental disability was, you know, seen in India. You can see multiple examples in films also, you know, how if a person is, you know, having some sort of mental disability, his or her relatives would, you know, take him to a certain, say, a shrine, or they would take him to a certain pandit, or they would take him to a certain Sufi Baba who would, you know, maybe do a jhadu on them, or, you know, try to, you know, cure it. And it is also seen as some sort of, you know, somebody has, you know, taken over their body, exorcism. This you can also see in a film like Bhool Bhulaiya, where, you know, towards the end, you see that entire paraphernalia where, you know, they take out Manjulika's, you know, the way it is seen as, you know, Manjulika's ghost from Vidya Balan's body. But, you know, the fact that she has a sort of bipolar disorder, but the way it is treated here, you know, through a religious gaze, through a gaze where, you know, you are treated, you know, you are taken to these religious shrines, or, you know, to these religious people to get yourself cured. Something we see in our, you know, culture also. I was reminded of this one trip where, you know, my friend asked me if I wish to, you know, come along with her to Mendipur Balaji. Has anyone been to that place? This is a place in Rajasthan. Mendipur.
I have heard about
them. Yes, ma'am, in there.
So this is a very similar place like Shahadola's shrine. Shahadola was a Sufi saint, but when you go to Mendipur Balaji, this is a place where they worship Lord Hanuman. Balaji is one of the names given to Hanuman. And there, you know, the people would bring their relatives who have some sort of mental disability. And there are a lot of notions associated with that place. And some things like, you know, if you, and this is something that I'm telling you very candidly, one of my friends, you know, and she's a very close friend. And she would, you know, she was telling me about this place where, you know, if you go in there, and if you have, say, for example, somebody, you know, and in a very crude way, she told me that, agar tumhare andar koi hai, to tum wahan se bahar nahi aa paoge. So this is how, you know, mental disabilities are seen in India as some sort of, you know, there is a sort of monstrousness related to it. And this is a different kind of monstrousness, something that you would not witness in the West. Like yesterday also we were talking about, if, say, for example, you know, if a child is born with four or two extra limbs, you know, he or she is seen as a swaroop of Devi or some sort of god. But if that kind of instance happens in the West, you know, you would be treated very differently. You would be maybe a part of a freak show. But that will not happen in India because of its situation, because of its religious, you know, the kind of things we believe in. So religion plays a huge importance in India. And when we will discuss about the films, you know, that, you know, I will take over, you would also see how in most of the films you would find that the parents have taken their child to some, you know, to a religious place, or they have called some sort of religious Baba at home to do that kind of jhadu thing on their head, so that, you know, they could be, you know, the kind, if there is a ghost in their body, and this is how they define it, it could be, you know, exorcised. Okay. Now, when we talk about India, autism is something that you would come across in a, you know, and it's a very contemporary, you know, diagnose being, you know, somebody who, you know, a child with autism or a person with autism. It's a very, very contemporary diagnosis. You know, you would not find autism, you know, before 1980s. There was nothing like autism in India before that. Although it was there, but the terminology autism and, you know, taking it, you know, that seriously that you go to a medical professional or you go to a psychiatric professional to talk about it. This never happened in India before the 1980s and 90s. So this is a very, very, say, new kind of developmental disability that we can come across, that we have, you know, that we see these days. And there's a dialogue that is taking place about, you know, these kids who have autism, and the fact that it's a huge spread, it's a huge spectrum. You know, if somebody is, you know, there could be an extreme kind of, you know, autism in a person. There could be a mild kind of autism in a person. So it depends, and it's a huge spectrum, and that kind of things you can see in the films also. And we will come to that. And autism is, you know, something that would impact basically the three. It would impact at three levels. One is socialization, right? And there would the child who has autism will face, you know, problems in socializing with the able-bodied world, the so-called able-bodied, or say the so-called neurotypical world. Now, this is a word that you would come across when you read about autism and other developmental disabilities. Neurotypical, neuroatypical, neurodivergent, right? Now, that child or that person would face you know, issues in socializing, in communication, and there is that person or that child will have a different kind of imagination, which will not fit in the social setup that we talk about as an ableist setup. So therefore, these people, the kids, the children who have, you know, who are dealing with autism spectrum, you know, they would be seen as disabled, they would be seen as, you know, people who are atypical, they would be seen as people not fitting in the social setup. And persons with autism would fail, you know, would face social awkwardness in, you know, communicating, in, you know, being social with people, in, you know, in the basic, like, you know, maintaining an eye contact, maintaining a conversation, you know, and people would call them whatnot. We will discuss all that. And they would be subjected to merciless bullying and sort of teasing. You would see people around you, right? You would have, you know, if you go back to your classrooms, there will be a student, there will be a friend who, you know, who was a little shy. There will be a friend who, you know, was not able to socialize with a lot of people. We might call people with autism as introverts, but there could be something more there. So it's very important to understand that people can be different neurologically, and they might think differently. They might imagine things differently. Not like me, not like us, right? And then, you know, autism has its own meta-narratives attached to it. What are these meta-narratives? The first one and the most important would be that, you know, it is seen as an enigma. You know, it is seen as an enigma, which is, you know, difficult to understand, which is difficult to unravel. And because, you know, we live in a setup which is, you know, governed by religion a lot, it is also seen as a curse. Parents ke bure karmo ka phal hai ye, ya iske bure karmo ka phal hai ye. So this idea of karma and fate that is actually, you know, prevalent in when we look at all disabilities. And this idea of a person in a permanent state of childhoodness. So this idea that, you know, the person, you know, it's a grown-up person, but there's a child in that. So you are constantly stuck at that stage of childhoodness. And we will see that in the movies just now. Then at times, you know, it is also seen as a state of divinity. As I was just mentioning before, that in India, you know, it's a different, you know, a way of looking at these things. When you look at disabilities, at times you're also seen as divine people, right? Therefore, you know, there's a term like Divyang for the people, you know, for the disabled people. And then this idea of divine innocence and sometimes, you know, these, you know, the idea of, you know, calling somebody Bhola, or say, I am a Punjabi, so, you know, in Punjabi, you would call somebody a Challa. Now, who's that person? Somebody who is very innocent and who is different from you. So the fact that you cannot understand, you call that person as Jhal or Jhali. Right? This is a very crude way of, you know, how somebody is seen as. Now, there are also, you know, other metaphors attached to a person with autism, like, you know, not having that kind of worldly wisdom. Therefore, you always need somebody to take care of you. You would always need somebody to assist you. And there is this, you know, stage of diagnose hunting throughout. The parents would go from pillar to pillar, you know, finding a, you know, diagnose for their kid, and would do anything to cure it. And this is something that we will see in the films also. And there's a lot of mother blaming. This is very important when we talk about autism. Because, you know, there's this idea of, just let me go to another slide here. Yeah, this is called refrigerator mothers. Now, what is a refrigerator mother? This is a fairly new idea for India, but this has always been here. Like, you know, this is a phrase that, you know, has recently come up when you read disability studies in India. But this idea of refrigerator moms has always been here. Now, who are these refrigerator mothers? Now, when we talk about autism, the entire blame of a child being autistic is put upon the mother. Now, the fact that, you know, she is not able to take care of the child properly, not able to teach the child the proper social behavior, the proper social etiquettes, how to behave in a society. So the idea that the motherhood is faulty. So this faulty motherhood is something which is termed as refrigerator mothers. It's a very patriarchal idea where, you know, it's given by Leo Kanner. And this is a person that you would come across if you read about autism. He wrote a paper in 1943 on, you know, and he was the person who gave the term autism. And he talked about how it's actually the fault of the mothers and how, you know, they are not able to take care of their children. Therefore, there is that kind of abnormality in the child. So this is something that came in the year 1950s and 60s, and it was also autism was also known as childhood schizophrenia. It was also equated with a mental illness, right? But this is not actually a mental illness. It's a developmental disability. So, and why it was blamed onto the mother? Because of the, again, there are binaries where mothers are, you know, domesticated, how they need to be, you know, a part of the private space, and fathers would, you know, take, you know, the public space. So there is always that binary opposition. And why, you know, if a mother is not able to, you know, diagnose it properly, if a mother is not able to take notice of the first, you know, early signs of, you know, if a child is autism. So the entire blame of that was put on the mother, calling her a refrigerator mom, that she is stuck there in a refrigerator and she is not able to defrost the child. So this kind of imagery was used in a paper like that, right? So I'm going to read from the slide here about refrigerator mothers. The overdetermined construction of the mother as a repository of unquestioning devotion and the source of unending care becomes particularly salient in the context of mothering a child with a developmental disability. Across cultures, the central role attributed to the mother in determining the developmental pathways of a child results in the mother often being blamed for her child's atypical or non-normative development. These theories about failing refrigerator mothers were premised upon a gendered binary opposition between the public masculine sphere and feminine private sphere, wherein the father carried the outside work and enacted the role of breadwinner, whereas the mother's domain was a private sphere of home, bearing and rearing children. The ideology of separate spheres is at the heart of the modern industrial nuclear family, and the ideal family is portrayed as a harmonious, stable nuclear household with an economically successful father and an angelic mother. So the idea that you blame it onto the mother is something which is seen in the films also. Something like Barfi, where, you know, the character of Jhilmil. Now, if you see the introductory scene where Jhilmil is, you know, the first scene where Jhilmil appears, there's a narration that goes in the background that talks about the alcoholic mother, right? And there's another film that I will refer to here, which is Tehzeeb. This was a film where, you know, you would find a character like Nazo, and her mother is played by Shabana Azmi, who is a singer, who is also the breadwinner of the family. So the situation becomes even more complex if the woman is also the breadwinner and also the person who's taking care of the children in the house. So she is seen as a selfish mother there, who is thinking about, you know, earning and making a name for herself. And Shabana Azmi in this film is, you know, constantly criticized for, you know, bringing this kind of disability on her child, on her daughter, Nazo. And Barfi is something where, you know, and I will share a scene here from the film Barfi, which will give you a clear idea of what I'm telling. Can you see it, Dharmendra?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now the scene that I'm going to play, it talks about Jhilmil. It's the scene where the character of Jhilmil is getting introduced. And there is a narration that goes in the background. And it talks about why, you know, Jhilmil is in a special home called Muskan. And maybe, you know, why she is like this. Right. So I'm just going to play this here.
Jhilmil.
So you see Jhilmil in a special home called Muskan, and she is coloring on the wall. This is something that you would see in a lot of autistic kids, that they like to color, and the crayons are their favorite, and you would see them coloring and drawing, and, you know, whatever they feel, they would usually draw. So you would see Jhilmil drawing something on the wall, and it's basically a house that she is drawing. And this is a scene where, you know, she has been asked to leave the home, Muskan, and go with her parents. And she doesn't want to go and live with her parents because of the behavioral, anomalies in her parents. So let us just continue with the scene.
Jhilmil.
And if you see Jhilmil here, the kind of clothing she is wearing, it's as if, you know, she is a child. And the something that I was mentioning before, how autistic kids, how people with autism are always, you know, assumed that they are stuck in a permanent state of childhoodness. So even the characters that are created, and this is something that I would you know, mention in another scene also. I'll show you another scene from the film Tehzeeb here. There again, you know, you would see Nazo, you know, dressed as a kid, and she is holding a doll in her hand, and the kind of treatment that is given to her in the house, it's as if, you know, she is a child. So the family assumes that you are constantly stuck in a state of permanent childhoodness. And the person who's talking to Jhilmil right now, he is the head of the school, Muskan, and he is like a caregiver here for Jhilmil. But now that Jhilmil is asked to move with her parents, Jhilmil is reluctant to basically go with her parents. And this person who is standing next to her is the head of the school, who's telling her that you need to go with your parents.
ने सारे बच्चों में झिलमिली दाजू की सबसे लाडली थी और हो भी क्यों ना, वो थी इतनी प्यारी, दाजू का बस चलता तो वो कभी झिलमिल को जाने ही नहीं देते। शराबी माँ, जोहरी घर जमाई बाप, झिलमिल को समझने के लिए बहुत प्यार और धैर्य की जरूरत थी।
I will share another scene here, a very similar scene from the film Tehzeeb. So this is the introductory scene of Nazo, who is the sister of Tehzeeb. Tehzeeb and Nazo are two sisters, and Tehzeeb is basically the caregiver for Nazo because of the absence of the mother, and their father committed suicide. Actually, not suicide. Tehzeeb actually felt that her mother had killed the father, but it was actually a suicide. So this is something that happens within the story. Maybe you can watch the entire film for that. But this is the introductory scene for Nazo. You may have a look at it. Again, you would see that Nazo is dressed in a very childlike manner. She has stuffed toys around her. And throughout the film, you would see her disability is not named. And I think this is something that is observed, you know, that one can observe in a lot of films where, you know, you would not name the disability, right? So something like this happens in this film also, where she is treated like a child, but throughout the film, you would see she would have certain other aspirations too, and she would voice them as well. But the kind of treatment she is given, it is as if she is still a child.
Glass of milk, please.
And if you see the kind of background score that is played along with, you know, the scenes of Nazo, it's as if, you know, it's a very childlike music that you would play for like a lullaby kind of music in the background score, right? And right.
Yes, good morning. Mm. Come on. Yes, my good. Yes, come on. Nazo, ye kya phir se wahi badtameezi hai? ये एक बार और किया ना तो तुझे उसी बस कैद खाने में भेज दूंगी। अस्पताल में जाके रहना है नाजो. I'm sorry, baby. ऐसे नहीं करते. अब अच्छे बच्चे की तरह नाश्ता कर ले. Sorry. अच्छा दूध नहीं, बस दूध. इट्स ओके आई एम सॉरी.
सॉरी.
इट्स ओके माय चाइल्ड.
सो द फैक्ट दैट शी टॉक्स अबाउट कैद खाना, राइट? दिस वर्ड दैट शी यूजेस हियर ऑफ कैद खाना इज समथिंग दैट यू नो आई वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट just a few minutes back about this psychiatric gaze that was that you would observe in the films say around 90s and 2000s, early 2000s. There were a lot of films that had this reference to hospitals and institutions where, you know, these women or these men who had some sort of mental disabilities were, you know, admitted to these institutions and hospitals, right? So let me just go back to my PPT. So for Nazo, her sister becomes the caregiver, and this is something that happens in most cases where you would see a female figure becoming a caregiver, either a mother or a sister. A father or a male member of the family would become a caregiver only in case there is an absence of a female figure in the family. It is usually the women in the family who are expected to take up the caring role. Shubhangi Vaidya in her essay writes that the dirty work of cleaning, washing, handling bodily wastes and exudations, which is a part and parcel of the everyday reality of caring for a person with profound disabilities, is conceptualized as women's work. More so if it involves the care of her own child. Right. So in both these films, you would see there is an absence of mother figure. Again, going back to that narrative of refrigerator mothers. But for Nazo, you would see there is Tehzeeb, her sister, doing the work of a caregiver. For Jinbil, and I think that it puts the film Barfi, you know, in that zone of where you would try to analyze this character of Jinbil, where, you know, she would need that kind of assistance. But where is that female figure around her? You would see her as a woman dealing with issues of womanhood, dealing with issues of femininity, but nowhere you would see any woman character around her. It is only later that you see a contrasting figure that enters the scene, which is actually the love interest of Barfi. So you would see, you know, that kind of contrast being created, but never in the film is there, you know, there's a discussion around what Jinbil actually feels about, you know, the issues that Jinbil might have come across as a woman. So you would not see those kind of, you know, discussions in the film. Now there is also a devaluation of care work despite its contribution to the public good. Women are made prisoners of love and exploited for their emotional labor. This is something that you would see in multiple films, how, you know, women would devote themselves totally for the person who is unwell, for the person who has some sort of disability. So there's this idea of pure devotion when it comes to women. Now, when we talk about autism, one needs to understand that it's not a neurotypical brain that we are talking about. We're talking about a neurodivergent brain. Now, what is a neurodivergent brain? It's a brain which will think differently, which will perceive things differently, which will act differently, right? So when we talk about these issues, we also need to see how the films are representing this different brain, right? Now, when we talk about Tare Zameen Par, it was able to capture that kind of difference to some extent. When we look at Ishan's paintings, when we look at how the character of Ishan develops in terms of how he's painting, and, you know, you would also see that towards the end he's winning a competition. that creates a problem in the film, which we will discuss in a while. But this idea that, you know, the brain is working differently is something that is highlighted, you know, that needs to get highlighted when we are talking about autism, when we are talking about some sort of developmental disability. We need to take into consideration that there could be a different brain thinking differently. There's also a film called Ahaan. Now, this is about a boy who has Down syndrome. And I will also show you its trailer here. And interestingly, Ahaan is played by a person who himself has Down syndrome. And this is actually one of its kind. Let me just show you. So I'm going to show you the trailer of Ahaan and how a person with Down syndrome looks at things, right? So you, in the trailer, you will see Ahaan, talking about his desires, his aspirations, and he's an adult boy and who works with his mother. His mother is a baker, and he would work. The film has its own problems, which we can discuss. But what I'm trying to show here is that there is a neurodivergent boy playing himself in the film. So this is something interesting, and it doesn't, you would not see something like this happening in the films, right? So have a look at it.
Yeah, so ready?
Ready.
Okay, dull ball.
Dull
ball. Ahaan ready, bother ball, Ahaan hit the
six.
Arre baap, kitna
baap. Ha, maam, Ahaan.
So the screen says, meet Ahaan. And Ahaan is dressed, you know, in a, and he's going for a party, and he's asking his mom, how do I look?
Look.
So now what happens is Ahaan meets this person who himself is having like a mental disability called OCD, right? So it's very interesting how a person with development disability meets another person who's dealing with a mental disability.
Your wife has left you.
Why?
Sex nahi hota.
Your OCD
just drives me nuts.
Anu, ruk jao yaar, kya kar rahi ho?
Let me go.
Andar aaoge?
I'll pick you up.
Okay.
11:30 below where you stay. Our secret.
So now this person uses Ahaan so that he could get his wife back, right? So earlier he would hate Ahaan for what Ahaan is. But now that he needs to, you know, get his wife back, he would use Ahaan for that purpose.
Doesn't matter.
Aunty.
Yes, sweetie.
Using poor Ahaan for your selfish needs.
I have nothing to say to you.
कल से तुम किधर बाहर नहीं जाओगे
Ahaan, I'm really sorry.
Ahaan says he wants to earn money. He wants to have his own house.
I want my friend. Pashadi.
So basically, you would see a person with Down syndrome playing himself in the film. But again, you would see, now the kind of problems that you would see with the film is that it again falls back into this idea of this person who has a disability as something who would help others to change their heart. So he becomes like a catalyst there who would, you know, help the able-bodied people to understand themselves, right? To measure themselves. So he becomes like a parameter where you could weigh yourself that, you know, if, and he would basically be a catalyst to help this person get his wife back.
I want two children, one boy, one girl.
Ahan ke saath waqt bitane ke baad, I've realized we complicate things a lot. He's so simple, uncomplicated, no pretenses, and he's all heart.
What do you want to be in 10 years?
Ahan.
Girls love compliments. Jaise, you have a beautiful smile.
So this film got
beautiful
released,
eyes, beautiful hair.
Last year, in 2021. And again, this film brings back this idea of savant syndrome. Now, you would see these characters in, you know, playing disabled and how, you know, they would be basically helping out others. You know, in their own world, they would basically lead to, you know, others getting cured. This is how, you know, you would see in a lot of films, something like this is also happening in Lal Singh Chadda. Now, if you have seen the trailers of this film, which is actually based on a Hollywood film, Forrest Gump, you would see how this idea gets translated. And this is something that I'm going to talk about in my next slide. It's called Savant Syndrome, where, you know, you see extraordinary skills that a person with autism sometimes, you know, he would have. And that kind of reference you also saw in Tare Zameen Par, where, you know, Nikum sir was basically telling Ishan about these different people who had dyslexia before and, you know, who have done so well in their life. But there are times when, you know, people with autism, people with dyslexia might not have that kind of extraordinary talent. So where do a film like Tare Zameen Par lie then? You know, how do you look at this film, you know, where it shows that Ishan is getting an award towards the end? Not all people, not all children with autism would have these kind of extraordinary talents. So when you bring in this kind of idea of, you know, some sort of extraordinariness in a person with autism or in a person with disability, you fall back again into that narrative of normality. Right? This is how you bring these characters back into that social setup of able-bodiedness. So you're basically overcompensating, something that we have discussed a lot in the previous sessions also. How, say for example, Michelle needs to get that one degree to prove herself to the world. So somebody who has autism will have to have this kind of, you know, extraordinary talent, or, you know, this person will have these kind of very simplistic qualities, as we just saw with Ahan, that, you know, he would be helping out able-bodied people to, you know, rectify their marriages. So this idea is something that you would see in a lot of films. Something like this you also saw in My Name is Khan, that this general idea that an individual on autism spectrum will have an extraordinary talent, as quasi-holy innocence, whose narrative function is to inspire those around them to be better people, right? So they come out as inspiration for the able-bodied people. Something like this could be called as a normality genre, right? Now, what is a normality genre? Now, when we go back to, say, for example, if we look at a film like Black, or say, if we look at a film like Tare Zameen Par, towards the end, what is the kind of feeling you get? Anyone?
Hi, this is Ria.
Hi, Ria.
So I think that when I was a child and our school took us to see Tare Zameen Par in the theaters, and the immediate reaction when we came back was, agar aise bacche kar sakte hain to tumme koi dikkat nahi hai, tum bhi karo.
Tum to kar hi sakte ho.
Tum hi to kar hi sakte ho. Agar wo ye
this is what it is.
Yeah. And also you mentioned about that seventh syndrome. I also come across on Facebook, or generally you see all these the people who are even on wheelchair, or they have some kind of a psychomotor disabilities. They are always put up with a motivational quote. And I don't understand why. Because then it they kind of, you know, trick or try to say again to feed this to the people watching the feed that okay, that see, learn from them, they are so inspirational. And right. I think that is what my reaction, because again it was something which was fed to us that you should be, tumhare paas koi aisa problem nahi hai, so you should be doing such great things.
Could you mute yourself? Somebody has their microphone on. Yeah. Thank you, Ria, for that. Now, I also want to ask, since Ria just mentioned about, you know, this idea of agar ye kar sakte hai, toh tum toh kar hi sakte ho. Right? When we talk about something like this, and this is something, and it's okay, you know, we need to talk about these things in a very candid manner. Sometimes, you know, we need to be open about these things. When we are doing a workshop, it's very important to, you know, unpeel all these things. That is why we are here. Now, this idea of special kids, right? Ye special hai. Anyone? This being a special kid. क्या सारे बच्चे आपके आसपास अगर आप देख पाए किस अगर कोई डिसेबल्ड है तो वो है स्पेशल इन अ वे दैट यू नो हैविंग दैट काइंड ऑफ एक्स्ट्राऑर्डिनरीनेस दैट वी टॉक अबाउट क्या सारे बच्चे वो अवार्ड ला पाएंगे जो ईशान को मिला था तारे जमीन पर में
आई गेस समबडी इज देयर सो आई विल टॉक लेटर ऑन आई एम सुमित एंड समबडी वाज टॉकिंग एक्चुअली.
Oh, we can take it one by one. Yeah.
I will go after Sumit. I mean, Sumit.
Yeah, yeah, please. It's okay. One by one. We can go one by one.
Shall I start, Mansi?
Yes, yes, please.
Yes, yes. This is Sumit Garg, and it's really nice to be, to be the part of this whole Drishtikon 2.0. See, I guess that whenever we talk about any special child or like that, we actually kind of miss the difference between disability and disease. What I think, one should actually know the clear-cut boundaries between what is a disease and what is a disability. So if we'll, you know, kind of come to know about more about these things, and these boundaries will be more, you know, kind of darkened, kind of we make them more fast, then it becomes, you know, easy to understand that, okay, this is disability. And if a person is with a disability, it is not a problem. They also have a right to live. We should also blur these kind of boundaries also. But, you know, one thing which I must say, sometimes I really feel that these movies or even literature, they push too much, and the life around us is not all that complicated. No doubt, whenever we see a special child, we have got sympathetic attitude towards that child. We want that child to be normal, you know, without understanding the concept of what is actually normal. These are there. But, you know, this difference, we need to know this difference. You know, obviously a disease is to be cured, and a disability is not a disease to be cured. This is what one needs to understand. This is what my take on this thing.
We'll come back to this idea of being special and being normal, Sumit, because I think this is what, you know, the entire workshop is all about. You know, questioning these ideas, these ableist ideas of, you know, assigning somebody that status of being special. Is it tokenism, or is it actually like that? Right.
No, so I guess, this is
something that I'm just coming to your point. Why we need to question these endings. You know, the other day I was talking about how a film starts and how we need to look at how a film starts and how a film is ending. So this idea of, you know, Ishan winning an award gives him the status of being that special kid. Right? what I'm asking you to problematize here is, are we again going back into that binary? Are we again going back into, you know, assigning that status of him being normal again? Are we putting back again Ishan into that category now that he is able to win this award? He's like others. He's like others. He's normal again.
I guess there is one thing which I just want to, put in.
Yeah.
That, earlier, if I draw a normal probability curve, the bell-shaped curve, which the other day, somebody was talking about.
I was talking about it.
Yes, you were talking about, sorry. And, he was on the left side earlier, and then he was put on the right side.
He was not on the right side. He was put under the bell. He came into the bell, right?
No, I guess when he won the award, he is a great painter, like his sir Nikunj. He becomes again very, very special, gifted child in terms of painting.
Basically, to become that, to gain that status of being an able-bodied person, he needs to push himself.
Of course.
Yes. So this is what I am basically coming to. Now, when I talk about normality, John, right? When we talk about these films who are, towards the end, you would see everything coming back to normal again, right? So what one is doing here is that you are again creating that kind of imagery of where, you are assigning.
Speech mode talk.
Hello.
Audio now muted alert. Audio.
Can you just mute yourself? Somebody's microphone is on. Yeah, thank you. So I'll just read from the slide here where I've noted a few things from Paul Dark's essay where he talks about normality genre. He writes, abnormality is used in cultural imagery to define the parameters of normality, not vice versa. It creates the simulacrum through which most apparently normal people live their lives. Thus, there is a coherence, I feel, to disability imagery that has been ignored through a failure to see the role abnormality plays in creating normality. Through creating the illusion of normality out of the apparent reality of abnormality. So basically, when you portray an abnormality, you are basically hinting at what is normal, what is normality. And when you look at these endings, it's very important to understand how this genre works. Why do I call the genre normality drama genre rather than impairment, disability, or abnormality genre? What is at stake in films that have superficially impairment or disability as their central theme is not the impairment or the abnormality, but the degree to which it can either define or validate its opposite, normality. Now, what happens when you go back home after watching these films? These are the feel-good films. We talked about this in the previous sessions also, how again, you would see these films conforming to those attitudes, conforming to those ideas of able-bodiedness. So the logical corollary is that the audience leaves satisfied as their own attitudes and conformist lives are validated towards the endings of these films. Something that you also saw in Parizameeper, something that you would also see in Ahaan. I'm saying, although the film would, it had a Down syndrome person with Down syndrome playing himself, but again, it falls into that category where, that normality is, intensified by showing you this abnormality, right? Now, when we talk about how do you represent autism, there's this writer called Stuart Murray. Stuart Murray, in his book, Representing Autism, when you read the text, you would see he's spending some 18 pages and he's giving you a description of, how he chose the cover page of his book. And he was very conscious of the fact that he did not want to, create an like like a plastic image of autism. So he wanted something more out of it. Now, when he talked about autistic brains, he wanted actually to underscore what goes inside an autistic brain. Right. So I'm reading from the slide here of, you know, how he thought of, you know, how he thought differently about the cover page of his book. So he, in the cover page of his book, you would see a photograph of two girls there. And why he chose it, this is something that I'm reading from the slide. The girls in Bond's photograph are present, and it is the fact of their presence that needs to be reckoned with, understood, and listened to. It is the autistic presence in all its many forms that is the core of all attempts to discuss agency, very important, and legitimacy in those subjects for whom autism is in some way part of their representational existence. It is also autistic presence that resists the many discourses that would simplify or ignore the condition. The material nature of such presence, the excess it creates when confronted with an idea of what normal human activity or behavior might be, stubbornly refuses to be reduced to any narrative, medical, social, or cultural that might seek to contain it without reference to its own terms. So this is something in short of, you know, what he was trying to do with that photo of the book, right? So coming to this idea of autistic brains, you know, autistic minds, there's this animation cartoon that you can find on YouTube, and I found it, you know, it was very interesting to watch it, and I have taken a few clips from that. The cartoon's name is Pablo. Now, this is about a boy named Pablo and how, you know, he likes to draw. He's an autistic kid. And what happened in the making of this animation series, you would see it is actually Pablo's accounts that were created into an animation film. Now, he was a part, and his mother was a part in creating this animation series. So what I'm going to show you now is something in a very small way of what and how an autistic brain works, right? So I'll just show you a screen, one of the scenes here from Pablo. Okay, so now the cartoon that you would see is where Pablo has gone to a restaurant and something weird happens there. So none of you would actually see, you know, would feel something like this, but Pablo feels very differently about it. Let us just watch it. Also, try to listen to the opening song also. So the opening song goes like, he sees differently, he thinks differently, and he is a differently made boy, right? So I'll just start the clip. So the title of the cartoon here is, this episode is When Foods Collide. So Pablo is served his food in a restaurant and he doesn't like it, the way it is served. So I'll just play it. This is Pablo and this is his mother.
Here it comes, Pablo.
So he served fried rice and spaghetti hoops. But what happens here is the food that is served in the plate, it's mixed together, right? the loops of spaghetti and the fried egg are almost on each other. So Pablo doesn't like it. So he is very particular about it. And this is something that he would also express.
And chicken salad for you.
What's the matter, Pablo? It's what you ordered. Fried egg and spaghetti hoops. Is it too hot? It's too hot, you can blow on it to cool it down.
So the mother is trying to understand, that Pablo is feeling something. So she thought maybe the food is hot, so, you know, he's feeling discomfort about it. But it is something else, and he would try to express it to her.
Would you like to draw a picture?
So he would draw a picture of what the problem is. So now the film goes into animation mode, where you see the fried egg and spaghetti hoops, they are colliding. And it's a wonderful animation here, done with the help of, in a crayon-like manner, the way you would color with a crayon. It's made like that.
Meow! Why are you doing that? Can't you stay on
the plate? So this is the fried egg telling spaghetti to be on its side.
We can't help it.
It's the wind.
This is the spaghetti talking.
Somebody's blowing on us.
Stop touching me. I don't like it.
So this is Pablo, who's in a lot of discomfort about the food that is served to him. And these are Pablo's friends. So there's a bunch of animals around him who are his friends.
My food is upset.
Why? What's upsetting it?
What kind of food?
Fried egg and spaghetti hoops.
But you love fried eggs, Pablo.
I love fried eggs too. Especially the yellow bit in the middle.
And you love spaghetti hoops, Pablo, in point of fact.
But I wanted fried egg next to spaghetti hoops, not fried egg in spaghetti.
So he lists the problem there, but he wanted it next to it, not mixed in each other.
With spaghetti hoops all over it.
Right, so I'll stop this scene here. What I wanted to basically explain here is that the way, you would see an autistic brain being represented in the films would not, maybe take into consideration these little things of how somebody who is living with autism finds these very little things so important to themselves. For somebody who doesn't have autism, for that person, this might be just nothing, right? So, but for a person like Pablo, it meant a lot. And there is another scene which I wanted to also show, but I think I will skip that. Where, he wants his smell to be smelled. He has just used like a soap and he could not smell himself. So he's telling his friends that he has lost his smell. So he wanted his smell to be back and not smell like, say, a soap or a detergent. So it's very interesting. You can actually go to YouTube and watch. There are numerous episodes. It's so interesting to watch because this is actually, Pablo, a boy, was actually part of, writing this kind of animation. And this is something that is that talks about how autistic brains work differently. And one could actually look at an autistic brain as being neurodivergent, right? So I will move on to another aspect of invisible disability, which is the representation of schizophrenia. Now, in the films, you would see when we talk about schizophrenia, there's this lot of narrative about psychiatric oppression. In the film that Tehzeeb also, the scene that I just showed just a few minutes back, you saw Tehzeeb talking about how she uses the word qaid khana there. So many people who had some sort of mental disability, whether it's a bipolar disorder, whether it's schizophrenia, were admitted to, and it's actually a representation in the film where, you know, you would see these people being admitted to the hospital and given, you know, those electric shocks on their, you know, on their head, or maybe, you know, they are given forceful injections to make them sleep and, you know, to restrain their activity. Sometimes you would also see them, you know, in solitary confinement. Something like this you would see in the film Tere Naam, where, you know, Salman Khan suffers an injury in the head, and the way he's treated after that, it's a very problematic film in that way. The way, you know, he's put in a prison house. So one can actually relook at these films through the disability studies lens. A film like Wo Lamhe. Now, when you talk about this film, Wo Lamhe, Kangana Ranaut plays this person who has, you know, she has paranoid schizophrenia. And towards the end, you would see, you know, she is getting into a bathtub. And basically in that bathtub, she cuts herself and she commits a suicide. So this kind of ending you would see in a lot of films. Either you would see a person with a disability, you know, overcompensating for their disability, or you would see them, you know, rectifying their disabilities, or you would see them, you know, basically committing a suicide. Something like this was seen in Wo Lamhe, and there are other films also where, you know, it would deal with drug addiction. Now, this is something which has been, which I feel, you know, one can read under the disability studies lens, how, you know, your daily life functions are, you know, you would not be able to function properly if somebody has a drug addiction. So that puts you, you know, create a sort of disability, creates a sort of impairment. And that again could be read as, you know, a film under the disability studies lens. In a film like Fashion, where, you know, you see Kangana Ranaut playing a drug addict and eventually she commits suicide. And then something like Aashiqui 2, where you see this character who is an alcoholic. Again, you know, he is committing suicide at the end. So this idea of, you know, again, you know, normality being, you know, overruling at the end, and, you know, you have this, again, this idea of, you know, the social setup being sanitized. Where has that character gone? That character has committed suicide. So there is no space given to that person towards the end. And maybe suicide is the only option given to that person. And the way suicide has been glamorized in the film like Wo Lamhe, you know, the way she would pour rose petals into the bathtub, and, you know, the way, you know, she's going to, you know, arrange that kind of suicide. Something like this you also see in Dirty Picture, where, you know, Vidya Balan, you know, would commit a similar sort of, create a similar kind of situation where, you know, she would commit suicide. And this idea of how do you look at people who are, say, drug addicts? How do you look at people who have some sort of, you know, addiction? Whether it's alcohol, whether it is drug, should they be a part of the society, or, you know, they should be just totally eliminated? Something that a lot of scholars have talked about, how, you know, this idea of sanitization of, you know, the status quo is maintained. You know, the status quo is maintained towards the end. How do the films handle these characters? when you create a character like that, how do you take it? How do you create the character arc of that character? And what is the ending of the film becomes very important, because that is what you go home with, right? And 15 Park Avenue is another film that I wish one can discuss here. This is about this character, Meety. And she has like a dormant schizophrenia, which gets triggered after, you know, she is gang raped by a group of goons. And because of getting raped, her boyfriend rejects her. And so she doesn't get married to this person. And there's this, her condition worsens after that. And so she starts hallucinating. She starts hallucinating that she's married and she has two kids. So there are scenes in the film where you would see her sister watching her from the top. And the sister is played by Shabana Azmi. And, you know, again, you would see that that kind of contrast being created. There is this sister who is the so-called able-bodied figure, and she is working as a professor in the university. But there is another sister in the house who is, you know, kept hidden, kept at home. And there is a very prominent scene in the film where, you know, Wahida Rehman is, you know, playing her mother there, and she calls a pandit in the Sufi Baba in the house, and that person does jhadu on Meety to, you know, cure her of her disabilities. So representations like these become very important. Now, what happens towards the end of this film? Again, you know, the film falls, the kind of ending it creates, Meety is not able to fit in the world which is ableist, which is, say, neurotypical. She is not able to fit in this world which expects her to not hallucinate, which expects her to not just talk to herself. So she goes into a different parallel reality towards the end, and her family is basically trying to find her. She goes to this fictional house at 15 Park Avenue, and she is never to be found again. So again, you know, you see these characters being misfit, and there is no space given. But how the film excels in the kind of narrative it creates is because it's talk about the personal aspirations of this woman, Meety. She would talk about how she wishes to get married, how she wishes to take up these feminine roles of being a mother or being a wife, or say, for example, being the best sister, right? So film would talk about the aspirations of this woman, Meety, giving her that kind of agency, which is usually denied to women who have some sort of mental disability. But the film would also give you that kind of psychiatric and medical base. Now, when we talk about mental disability, there is also this idea of sexual violence that comes with it. So the women who have some sort of mental disability, they are prone to, you know, becoming prey to sexual violence. And if I have time, maybe I can show you one scene here. So this is a scene from the film Tere Naam, right? So there was this very small character in the film of Pagli. Now, using a word Pagli there, you know, and you would see her, you know, acting that way, that this idea of madness that is, you know, you would see being represented in the films. There's another film that I wish to talk about here, which is Pinder. So there was a very small character there of, again, this woman being called as Pagli. Now, one can reread these films using disability studies lens. How would you analyze women who have been raped during the time of partition or during the time of any sort of conflict, say the riots of 84 or say the riots, Gujarat riots, these women who were raped, how are they dealing with that kind of trauma? We would also talk about this idea of post-traumatic stress disorders in a while. Let me just show you the scene here. It's a very short scene of how women who have mental disabilities, they become this, they become an easy prey for sexual abuse. So this is a scene from a railway station where Pagli is basically requesting Salman Khan and his friends to, you know, get her some food. She is a beggar basically, and who is mentally unstable.
Hello.
So she's asking this person if, you know, he could get her some food, but he rejects it.
पैसे ये ले
अरे यात्रियों
चंदू हाँ इसे चाय पिला दे
ठीक है राधे भैया
बट बट पागल
अरे खैर ना देता हूँ ना चारा करूँ क्या छोड़ छोड़ क्या कर रही है
So you can see a person sitting next to the shop here on the left. This is a local goon, and something that he would do in a fraction of a second here is he would pull the string of Pagli's skirt, and you would see the fact that, you know, she would be asking for help after that.
Le, ले क्यों तंग करती है
बाय राधे चल कनक
बाय असलम
बाय कनक बाय
बाय चंदर
सो दिस आइडिया ऑफ मेल गेज And on top of that, a woman with a mental disability, how she becomes an easy prey to sexual abuse. Something like this you would also see in a film like Pinder, where this character of Pagli, and you know, again, she's a mentally unstable woman. And so she is raped again and again by the you know, during the time of partition, how she was raped by so many people. And I will share again a very short clip of how Urmila in that film would describe this idea of a woman who is mentally disabled getting raped. Just give me a minute. This is a scene from the film Pinjar, where these women are running after Pagli. She is not in a stable state of mind, and they are asking her to stop and have something. Later, you would see she Urmila is informed that Pagli has been raped, and she is pregnant with a rape child now, right?
पगली को देखा इन दिनों
नहीं तो
पेट उभर आया है
कैसा आदमी होगा वो जिसने
अरे जानवर होगा जिसने पगली की ये दुर्दशा बना दी
जिसके पास न हुस्न था न जवानी बस मांस का एक शरीर जिसे अपने सुध न थे हड्डियों का एक पिंजर एक पागल पिंजर चीलों ने उसे भी नोच नोच कर खा लिया
Yeah. So So the scene that you saw here, again, you know, problematizes this entire idea of how, you know, women with mental disabilities are seen and how, you know, they become an easy prey to this idea of gender-based violence. And something that you also saw in, you know, women with blindness. So women with blindness, women who have this some kind of mental disabilities are prone to, you know, being, you know, prey to some sort of sexual abuse. Now, moving on. So we just saw scenes from Tere Naam. We saw a scene from Pinjar. There was this other film called Sadma, which again dealt with this, you know, and you could actually see in the film also where she was sold to a prostitution house, this character of Sri Devi, after, you know, she has a mental disability. She starts behaving like a child. She starts behaving like childlike, and she is sold in a prostitution house to, you know, and there is, you know, there she would meet the hero of the film, Kamal Hassan, and, you know, he would, you know, bring her out of that prostitution house. So again, you know, there are multiple films that would, you know, give prominence to this idea of how women with mental disabilities are seen in the society, they being easy prey to sexual abuse. Then when we talk about mental disabilities, we again come back to this idea of, you know, this religious medical model of, you know, viewing disabilities. Even in the film like Sadma, you would see the way she gets cured is when, you know, she is taken to a pandit who does some sort of, you know, treatment to her, and, you know, he would give her daily treatment would be given to her to cure her of her mental disability. And towards the end, you see that, you know, she's getting cured and finally going back with her parents. Something like this you also saw in Tere Naam, where, you know, Salman Khan, towards the end, you know, he would go back again to that place and, you know, serve in that place where, you know, from where he could get cured. So again, he would become that kind of person who is curing people of their mental disabilities. Now, when we talk about mental health issues due to past traumas, we need to relook at films where, you know, these traumatic events have been described, something like, say, Gujarat riots. When we talk about Gujarat riots, there's this one film called Firaq. And if you go on to see this film, there's this character of Deepti Nawal in it, who has this, you know, she starts hallucinating that, you know, there's a girl who had come knocking at her door and she could not save that girl. So after that incident, she would pour hot oil on her just to get that feeling of how that burnt woman was feeling. So having that kind of trauma, and one could, you know, start looking at these films through this idea of disability studies and how being, you know, prone to trauma has created, you know, issues in the daily functioning of a person. And something like this one can see in Karan Arjun also. And I was quite thinking about this idea of motherhood, this total devotion of mothers and, you know, the representation of mothers in the film. And this prominent dialogue of Rakhi from the film that mere Karan Arjun aayenge. Now, why would she go on to say that even after 30 years? Why would she go on to say that even after 25 years of what has happened? And, you know, because she saw the killing of her sons before her eyes, that kind of trauma that she had gone through. So that kind of got manifested. Obviously, it's a film. So the kind of the melodramatic elements along with what she had gone through adds up to it, and, you know, they would create a film like Karan Arjun. So one can actually look at these films also. Something like it was also visible in Heather, when, you know, you would see Heather standing at that signpost and, you know, he would give that long monologue about, you know, hum hai ke hai nahi. to be or not to be. So one can analyze these texts, texts like Hamlet, texts like Heather, through the disability studies lens. Highway as a film, you know, when she talks about what happened with her in childhood and how, you know, even when she is an adult, she could feel how, you know, it has manifested in her. So the past traumatic events get manifested in the present, and how are they getting manifested? So one can look at these films also. Now, there are films that have tried to create a dialogue on how do you treat mental health issues. One such film was Dear Zindagi. Although the film, one can say it came from a very privileged, obviously it's a very, very privileged position from where this character comes from, who can afford therapy. The affordability of therapy is something that one needs to look at when we talk about, you know, India as a country, and we look at these mental health issues. It's not available to everyone. This idea of therapy is not available to everyone. Something like autism cannot be detected, you know, in a rural setting. It would go ignored. Autism gets detected, and this is something that people like Milika Mehrotra, people like Shubhangi Vaidya have also observed, that intellectual disabilities and development disabilities is the reality of urban settings, not of rural settings. So when we talk about therapies, when we talk about, you know, this alternate way of looking at mental health issues, how would you, you know, find a way to manage them? How would you find a way to deal with these issues, not going for medical or psychiatric treatments? There is a treatment like therapy. There is a treatment. There is a way to look at it through therapies. There's a way to look at it through counseling. So these ideas are also very, very privileged in that way, but they open up a conversation about how to go about looking at mental health issues. And one can, you know, reread a lot of films, that were never recognized as films depicting mental health, but and mental health, mental disabilities. But one can reread these films, reread these invisible forms of disabilities. And I open the floor to you all. Can you just give me examples from, any film that you had watched, and maybe after this session you have started to rethink about it? Anyone?
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, as you talked about various films dealing with mental illness, ma'am, in this way, you have seen the movie Crazy 4.
Okay.
Yeah. In which we see Arshad Varsi, means his disability was not visible. But his aggression became a part of madness. And then one more thing I want to add, that in urban areas, you have talked that mental illness became popular. But in middle classes or lower middle class, depression, which was not been considered as a problem, I want to share two incidences of educated family and uneducated family, ma'am. My sister, a distant sister, who suffered from depression in his high school, and his father was educated, so he has taken her to a psychiatrist, and she recovered in a year. And a person who is suffering from depression from his high school, but even today he was not recovered from this, and now his depression became a mental illness. And his father, who was not educated but belonged to a privileged class, so he has spent more money from 2005 till today. And ma'am, one thing I have also noticed, that these rehabilitation centers and these doctors were not treating them properly. They just tried to earn money and becoming richer and richer. Before 1 year, I sent that person to a rehabilitation center, and they have taken at least 50,000-60,000 rupees for 2 months. But after that, he came out, and after 15 days, he became as usual, as panic, as depressed. So I believe that what to do with those middle class persons or means uneducated person, what they do to get means good consultations.
I think वो right diagnose होना बहुत जरूरी है.
Yeah,
like with autism also, early detection is something that can you know help the child a lot. And उसका वो there could you know these sessions, counseling sessions, therapy sessions can help a person with autism if it is detected at a very early stage. So I think वो एक right kind of detection बहुत जरूरी है चीजों का.
Yeah, ma'am. And one more thing, when you see the movie Main Aisa Hi Hoon, in which Ajay Devgan, and
right.
see the society, how society acts upon it, how he became a father, and his father-in-law was treating very badly with him. So that kind of movie also
definitely one can read it. See, that kind of film is very obvious in that way. I'm also hinting at films जो कि आपको बहुत ही non-obvious way में आपको mental disability और mental illness और mental health के बारे में बताती है. तो उस level पे भी हमें सोचना थोड़ा start करना चाहिए. When you know we, because I was the way I was thinking at about a film like Karan Arjun. It had a very strong impact. You know, if I talk about myself, I watched it when I was a kid. And this dialogue of, you know, Rakhi, Mere Karan Arjun Aayenge, and it's constantly hovering in the film. So how do you look at a person who is, you know, stuck in the past?
Living in that dilemma.
Yeah, so if you are living in the past, right? So how would you look at people like that? Usi tarike se when I start looking at a film like Kinjar, you know, you'd not just look at the character of Pagli. There are so many other women who were, you know, molested, who were raped. Yeah. What would have, you know, how? What kind of life would they be living after that kind of trauma?
Ma'am, one of the movie called Aaj, in which I have seen a deaf person whose daughter want to marry his beloved, but due to his deafness, his disability, he was unable to and take his daughter to his lover. That thing must be noticed by the audience that due to this disability, the whole society came over him. And ma'am, one thing you talked about normal and ableist society, that we call a people means a person is special. So being I'm also visually impaired, but I have seen that my normal friends, they say you are not looking blind, so there's something which is ingrained in their minds that if he's a blind, so he must
one should look like a blind to be blind.
And we see that in classes, teachers also make some kind of discrimination, but not in that kind, because when we see that if I have done something good, they say isne kar liya, tum log nahi kar pa. That things must be came to the
pattern. So yehi to sara jo hum baat kar rahe hain, cultures of ableism, yehi to hai sare kuch. Cultures of ableism, cultures of disableism. Ki kis tarike se even hamari daily terminologies, daily vocabulary mein itna ye sab kuch ingrained hai. Right? So wo sari unlearning ki bahut zarurat hai hum log.
Yes, ma'am. That kind of sensitization is very necessary in every institution, in every society. Thank you, ma'am. You touched every point which I was very, which I'm very happy.
Thank you so much.
Yes,
ma'am. Thank you. Okay. I'll take another question here. Yes.
Yeah. Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, Tripti.
Yeah, ma'am. There is a South movie which.
Sorry, you are muted.
Ma'am. There is a South movie which name is the Kuthai Raival. It means the horse tail. It was released in 2021.
Can you repeat the name, Tripti?
Ma'am, it's Kuthai Raival, which means horse tail. Horse tail.
Horse tail.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, ma'am, it's South movie. The original name is Kuthai Raival, which means in English, Horse Tale. It was the movie was released in 2021. So the thing is that wherever we are talking about the absence of physical, absence of body part, which is known as physical disability, and here we are talking about mental disability, right? So here we have what will happen if you have an additional body part in your body. So how could the person react? So in that movie, there is a horse tail. The name of the character is Sarvana, who is stuck in the path to know the reason behind the addition part, that is horse tail, on his back.
Achha.
So okay. this is also create the idea of having fear of disability, which is physical as well as mental disability. What will happen? How the people will react on me? Your fear of denialism, fear of disability, you know. And the later on, he comes to know it is a kind of psychological drama, you know, the magical realism.
I've noted down the
trying
name.
To understand why this horse tail. Yeah, ma'am, Kuthai Raival. This is something which I'm able to pronounce in that way.
I've noted the English name.
South movie. Yeah. And ma'am, it happens because this hostel is visible to him only. Other people are not able to see it.
Okay. So and does it also have some kind of superpowers attached to it?
Yeah, ma'am, it's all about the psychological dilemma in his mind, because horse tail is the symbol of sexuality. So some astrologer told him, because you are not able to marry the girl of your choice, so all the time you keep thinking about that girl, and, you know, because you want to be with her. So this horse tail is symbol of the sexuality, which you are intentionally, you know, controlling your emotions, because that was the only girl with whom you want to be. So the operation of sexuality is a symbol of horse tail. Achha. So this is something, ma'am, I just want to write something about that. You can say the abstract.
Definitely. Please do write it. It will be wonderful to read it. Thank you so much, Tripti.
Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am, to give me insight. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much, Tripti. Somnath?
Yes, ma'am. So basically, since we are talking about mental illness, and the other day I was talking about this series called Vikings, in which I pointed out this character
I remember,
the boneless, right? And that was a physical deformity.
Yeah.
But there's this other character called Floki, who is based on this ancient boat maker from old Norway. So there are many sources which define this character in many different ways. So one of the sources define him as a schizotypic personality disorder having character.
Okay.
Other sources define him as at the verge of schizophrenia, while certain other sources define him as a high-functioning schizophrenic, right? So this character, Floki, stands as very interesting because he is an ableist society, functioning as everyone else, and he's someone who really loves to be with his friends and family, but he apparently speaks for the gods, right? And he has these visions where he can actually think that Odin is giving him signs and symbols so as to make a sacrifice, and that is the reasons for which he also murders a Christian monk, right? So this character stands out as very interesting because he's someone having a mental illness which is undetected in a world that is not aware about anything of the sort.
Definitely. So you can do a rereading of that particular series, right? Using all these readings. And it's so interesting because, you know, when you start rereading it, you also try to understand that there could be people around you with the same things. And one needs to be very, very sensitive. And how do you become sensitive? Because when you start rereading these things, it is only then that will happen.
That's true, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Amrita?
Good evening, Mansi. So there's one movie that I wanted to talk about, which is a Kannada movie called Rangi Taranga.
Okay.
There is, I don't know how to translate it. It has no meaning in that sense in English. But in this movie, there are multiple characters who have mental illnesses. There's one girl who sees, who's almost sexually abused, and hence she, in an act of protecting herself, in an act of self-defense, she ends up killing the abuser before he does anything. And that trauma leads her to cause PTSD in her. She's extremely paranoid. She isolates herself, and she goes to the extent of finding a guy. She accidentally meets a guy with amnesia, and she ends up, building a fictional story just to building a fictional story in which both of them live a life separate from society and all of that. Like, she goes to extreme lengths to protect her identity because she's so paranoid that this guy might find her again or the police might find her and things like that. So this is actually a thriller movie. I had not looked at it from this point of disability studies, but there are a lot of, and there's another character who has killed his wife, and he has, I think, dissociative identity disorder because there's one personality in him which is a functioning socially, he's kind of, you know, accepted in society and all of that. And there's this other character who he becomes when he puts on this makeup of the, a dancer in Mangalore side. He becomes another character who keeps on going around and killing pregnant women. So there are multiple disabled characters in that sense. And this is a movie that I wanted to, reread in that sense.
Definitely. Please do that. Thank you so much, Amrita. Thank you.
Also, I had another question.
Yeah, sure.
We were talking about Karan Arjun. I was wondering, is Om Shanti Om can also be rated as a mental illness? Because he does hallucinate his past and things like that. He is also stuck in his past, like Karan Arjun's mother.
So, I don't remember the exact scenes from Om Shanti Om, but If you think it could be, please go ahead and, you know, have a rereading of the films. Because the kind of representations you would see, it's so important to go about thinking what are these filmmakers trying to represent. Something that I was mentioning when I read Stuart Murray's quote there, that he is very conscious of even the book cover there. Because the kind of image it would create in the minds of the readers, he doesn't want to give just any image of, you know, people with autism. He wants it to be, you know, about these people. And, you know, one thing that one can note about people with autism or people with, some sort of mental disability is that these people would always have somebody else advocating for them. Especially like, you know, somebody having autism, it would be either his mother, you know, or her mother, advocating for him or her, or somebody like, say, for example, Meethi in 15 Park Avenue, it is her sister who is always, you know, taking decisions for her. So this entire idea of agency is never in the hands of the people with mental disability or say some sort of developmental disabilities. So these ideas of how they are going to resist, how are they going to, you know, assert their agencies become so important. And when we start rereading these films, maybe we will be able to find those moments of resistances. Maybe we will able to create those moments of resistances of, say, evaluative gaze, psychiatric gaze, or medical gaze. So it's very important to reread these texts.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, Amrita. Sadhana?
Hello. Here I would like to mention two movies. One is Chichore, where because of parental aspirations and parental pressure, the boy commits suicide because he felt that he is not able to fulfill the parental aspirations. And similarly, in Three Idiots, where the boy commits suicide.
Yeah,
very true. Invisible, disabilities and the...
The pressures of society.
They have not given enough importance to look into the mental trauma and what is going on inside the minds of the children while there is so much of
pressure. And I think one needs to think about these issues because the people who we are talking about are all around us. So one needs to take care of people, right? And be very sensitive about how we deal with mental health issues.
Yeah, and similarly, their parents are also undergoing some kind of invisible disabilities where they have this in-depth desire to achieve something through their children. In that way also it can be seen.
So just this morning, like you just said, parents, I was just reading somewhere that, you know, parents should not, put their unresolved issues onto their children.
Right,
because parents might also have some past issues, some past traumas. Yeah. So one needs to break that cycle of trauma and not pass it on to the next generation.
And at times it's very difficult because they are coming with their past traumas, and many times along with that in their present life also they are undergoing some kind of trauma. So it creates a vicious cycle. Even if they want to come out from it, and even if they are aware of the behavior they are depicting, they are not able to come out of it. And many times, because it is invisible, people from the society they also become judgmental.
So this is actually the problem with invisible disabilities, because you need to identify. The identification of the, if there is some issue one needs to work on, if there is some issue one needs to resolve. So identifying that is something that becomes very important when we talk about invisible disabilities.
Yeah. And similarly, somebody was saying somebody went to rehabilitation center, and when he or she came back, and the person again started showing the symptoms of the same disorder. It may be because the family has not been able to provide the kind of environment that person was getting at rehabilitation center. So while the person is coming out, it is very important to have family therapy. That is why we say that family therapies are important. Every member of the family has to contribute that there is no relapse of the same situation.
I would like to add to that, Sadhana, not just family. There has to be a move where the community is involved.
Yeah, exactly. In
care of the citizens. The kind of support system you would build. Everyone should become very conscious of the fact that it has to be an inclusive space. And we need to create that comfortable space where we can talk about these unresolved things. Yeah. So it has to be a community care.
And
we need to move from family to community now.
Exactly. And thank you for making me a part of this wonderful workshop. And I really admire the way you have analyzed each and every movie through disability lens. And I really enjoyed every moment of the workshop.
Thank you so much. One question, sir.
I would like to ask, what motivated you to take this as your PhD topic?
It's a long journey. I started my journey in 2014. There were instances that basically, created curiosity in me. And then I actually got to know that there is actually a field which is like disability studies, and one can actually do, research on such issues. I have a few relatives who are disabled, and I would, not call myself an able-bodied now. At least now I would not call myself. We are all temporarily able-bodied people. So it's so important to, go inward. And this is something that I started in 2014. And there was this workshop that I had attended, which basically led to the entire process after that. And now, thankfully, it is emerging as an academic field. And we have a newly added a discipline in different universities also, and how they are taking this field forward. It's amazing to see that. When I started it, nothing like that was happening. So I'm quite happy that now actually, you know, I can actually see this change, you know, if there is, yes.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sadhana. Riya, yes.
Yes. So I came across, I mean, just got back to that angle where you talked about the intersection between disability and religion. Mm-hmm. And I was reminded of this movie called Rishte, which stars Anil Kapoor and Karishma Kapoor. So
oh, yes.
What you must have seen it. It was very popular on TV channels. So mm-hmm. I got reminded with the intersection that if anyone can remember that, what happens is that in that movie is their relationship gets broken off because the father is not very interested in marrying his rich daughter to this poor guy. Somebody who's an engineer or particularly works at a very menial job. And then they use a girl to create a difference between both of them. And then when Karishma Kapoor has to know about her, that this was all a fake incident created by her father, suddenly Shilpa Shetty is also in that movie, and she suddenly brings that woman and she's all burnt up. She's all burned. So then she says ki dekho isne aapke sath aisa kiya isliye isko bhagwan ne aisi saza di hai. I got reminded of that intersection we were discussing about, that it's also treated as something like ki physically aapko, if you go from a so-called able body to somebody who has faced this kind of a physical disability, it was a result of your karma,
definitely. Yeah. Yes, and that is there throughout. Matlab aap kitni se kitni purani film bhi dekh lijiye, that kind of narrative you would find in 1938, 1972, 2004 mein bhi aapko similar narratives milenge. How you know, this idea of karma, this idea of fate is so prevalent around us that we see a disability as some sort of punishment of the past
karma. Yes. Adding to this, I also wanted to know your opinion on body dysmorphia.
Body dysmorphia. Can you elaborate on that?
Because what happens is, because we have, I think both Priyam and your workshop has almost mostly touched everything, and I just came across some article where they were talking about an intersection between queer studies and body dysmorphia, that how a person who has this anxiety of coming out starts to feel that there is a problem with their body. That is why they are feeling this, and they start to dislike their body, which is again a compulsive order. Which is dysphoria means that they are not very comfortable with their own body. Okay. So, yeah. So, if you could comment anything on that.
The way you are explaining, Riya, all I can think about is some sort of body alienation that one can feel. But definitely, I will have to read that reading, because I will not comment on something that I have not read. Maybe we can, you know, take it up on email or, you know, chat. Body dysmorphia, I've noted it down. And maybe we can have a discussion around it. If you can share the reading, was it shared by one of us?
No.
Okay.
It was something where I came across the intersection. Actually, there's a Sri Lankan author, and there are a lot of authors who are South Asian and South East Asian.
So Sri Lankan author to Fiona Campbell hongi.
No, she was S.D. Sindhu.
Okay.
So in her works, there's a book called A Brief Marriage Story, something like that, where they talk about that how to, jaise ki Badhai wo movie thi. Badhai Do, abhi jo recently aayi, where there is a queer couple. So both of them have married someone else. But there's a kind of possessive attitude when you come to discuss these things, that they start feeling that their body is not their bodies are not perfect. I think that the book which I read, they try to establish a connection between both these fields.
Okay.
So, that is what I was looking
for. But of course, I can share the reading and we can discuss it further. Yeah, I have not read about this.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Ria. Sanskriti?
Hi, thank you for the session. It was really illuminating. So,
I think the readings, about the readings, I will share it. I read your message on the group. There was some issue with my scanner and, you know, the books that I have, you know, you can't open them fully.
Right.
Because of their stitching, na? It wasn't coming properly. So I could not share. I know even in the first lecture also, there were two readings that I had wanted to share. But what I can do is maybe I'll click pictures of that and pass it on to you guys. Yeah.
Thank you so much. I think somebody did share the books later, but if anything is left or you think anything else should be recommended, that would be great. So your discussion made me think of two movies, shows. One is from Hindi cinema and the other is not. So particularly your discussion of Pinjor made me think about whether there are any movies representing similarly for male trauma. And I thought of New York, the movie about 9/11. And I think because the meta-narrative of that movie is so much about terrorism, we don't think about that period where through that song, Mere Sang, they show the 9 months in the middle where he has an affective disorder very clearly.
Definitely. And you would see films about many other conflicts that one can list here. You know, the riots of 84, the riots of Gujarat. If you go on to, you know, unearth these films, maybe you will find so much of, you know, references that one can look at. And this is a very good example that you just mentioned. And I think post 9/11 and the trauma that people had to go through and how, you know, even today, there would be issues in the daily functioning of people. Right. And there was this brilliant scene in the film Heather. If you have watched that film, there, you know, there's this person standing outside his house and he's not going inside. And his house is, you know, in a dilapidated situation. So the wife tells Shahid Kapoor that he is so used to getting himself, you know, surveilled, that he's not able to move beyond that.
Right.
So this idea of constant surveillance, which is present in Kashmir and how, you know, it could impact people and the coming generations. And how it could lead to, you know, some sort of mental issues in people. Like if you talk about, you know, I'm a third generation of a displaced family from partition, right? So what did partition do to my memory, the post memory that I have of partition? So it would impact me in some way. I think it's so interesting to, you know, try to look at these narratives and maybe reread them through this idea of how they can impact you mentally.
Right, absolutely. And I think it started a conversation that we wouldn't have had otherwise, because when we watch these films, we don't read them from that lens because disability isn't discussed at all as a topic. They're just underlying narratives. So very quickly, the other one that I thought of, if you've seen it at all, is Modern Love. The episode where, so there's this episode, it's called Take Me As I Am, Who I Am, and it stars Anne Hathaway. And she's shown as a very successful attorney who's looking for love, but she suffers from bipolar disorder. And as somebody who has clinical depression, I had never before seen a representation of affective disorder in that way on screen. I had never seen a show showing us the peaks and falls of going through something like that. So they show us a scene where she's extremely charming, productive, highly driven, and then another scene where she's unable to get out of bed. Her entire house is dark. She's unable to even reply to a text or open the door. And I think that was so interesting to see because it also showed us how people think generally of somebody who has a quote-unquote half-functioning life as being thankless when they're unable to get out of bed, or self-pity. And we're constantly told to be thankful for the privileges we have, as if we can control or rein in our emotions. So I think that that's a really, really interesting representation as well.
Maybe I'll watch it. I haven't seen this model.
Right.
Thank you so much, Sanskriti. We are almost, 10 minutes past 8. So I will very quickly take maybe four. I have four hands here. Very quickly, Karishma.
Hello, ma'am.
Hi, Karishma.
A lovely session. I want to know your intake upon relationship between mental illness and loneliness. Once you feel isolated from, the society, after being knowing that you have a mental illness.
So the idea of mental health and loneliness, yes. This is what?
Yes.
Okay. Maybe I'll take all the questions and I'll club it together. Sure. Right? Yeah.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you, Karishma. Bhakti?
Hi, good evening.
Hi,
Bhakti. I wanted to talk about the normality genre part of the session today.
Yes, yes.
When we were discussing Tare Zameen Par and how disabled kids had to, we have this expectation that special, quote-unquote, kids have to have some achievement towards the end. Perhaps that part of the movie where they try to give this quote-unquote feel-good ending to it is a way to justify the terminology special.
Yes.
Because that very terminology has a very particular connotation to it, right? And it also makes me wonder whether it is this inherent capitalistic tendency within us that makes us want everyone to have a successful story. Because when we look at it this way, it's like the ending is less feel good, because it's less feel good, more feel bad, because there's this constant performance pressure that it's inducing all of us.
And this is what I was trying to hint at. Why would you try to make everyone so special? It's okay. One can be not extraordinary, one can be just ordinary, right? So it
perhaps,
puts so much,
Perhaps the labeling of disabled people as, physically special or mentally special, we must work on that, come up with a better terminology, definitely. Perhaps. Because, definitely.
I think you are right there. And it's so nice to see that, you were actually thinking on these lines. Thank you so much. Anna? Yes. Anna?
I'll just, yes, hello, Mansi. I'm just going to be very quick. Actually, I came
across... And please be very short.
I came across this K-drama. It's released only, it's showing number 7 in Netflix. And it's called Extraordinary Attorney Wu. And the description says that it's about a woman on the autism spectrum and she's a lawyer. But the trailer itself is it's completely full of just representing the person as the disability. That sort of... I've not watched it, but maybe
for the, you can watch it and we can discuss it.
Yeah,
there's another one that you can. Which is this one you said?
It's called Extraordinary Attorney Wu.
There's another one where this doctor is. He is on the autism spectrum, and he is a brilliant doctor.
Okay.
I think it's Doctor Something. Please check it.
All
and
right.
It is played by a young boy. And he, again, conforming to the Savant syndrome, having those extraordinary skills, how he's curing people in the hospital.
Okay.
With his eccentric character.
Right.
But, bringing back this idea of being extraordinary.
Okay.
All right.
It's okay to not be okay.
No, this is a different one. It's deals with the doctor. Please check it.
Okay.
Maybe I can share the name on the group.
Somebody type Dr. Strange.
And maybe Dr. Strange could be, yes. Yeah. Thank you so much. Aishwarya?
Hi, Mansi. Thanks so much for this.
Please be very quick.
Yeah.
Almost 8:15.
I also quickly just wanted to talk about the normalizing aspects of disability. So when we look at, you know, inspiration porn in movies, we often talk about and look at in how this inspiration porn gives a certain image of disability as something extraordinary and extra something to non-disabled people. We don't often talk about how it gives similar images to disabled people or like even definitely, disabled children definitely. And teenagers yes. watching the movies.
Right. So, and films like that, Tare Zameen Par would, you know, try to intensify that kind of situation where, you know, it puts so much pressure on the disabled person also to be, you know,
have maybe some to win great a prize skill.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. You're right there.
I want to look at, you know, movies from that lens.
Definitely. Please do that. Thank you. Anna, I think it's The Good Doctor. Somebody just mentioned on the group.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah. Nonita? Yes. And that's the last one that we're going to do. Yes.
Hello. Hi.
Yeah. Nonita, please be very quick.
Yeah. Hi. So I am a doctor by profession and I have attended this. Like, it's a good experience because even now we also have to teach MBBS students regarding disability competency.
Wow.
So I have used few films, so wanted to know more. And just for quick suggestion, I think in the movie Dar, which was Kajol and Shah Rukh Khan. So she had that obsession with Shah Rukh Khan, which resulted in impulsive killing. So it was kind of a like mental disability. Probably obsessive compulsive disorder,
maybe yes,
kind of thing. And also recently there was movie Kabil,
yes,
in which both the actor and actress were visually impaired. So and the actress gets raped. So it was based on that. So these two were the few suggestions. And also Karthik Calling,
yes. Definitely. It talks about the side of schizophrenia.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you so much, Nonita. And coming back to Karishma's question, how this idea of loneliness gets, you know, intersected with mental disability. I think that is true for any sort of disability. And this is something that we have seen throughout how you would see at these how the representation talks about these characters being so lonely and, you know, how they are always in search of somebody who would save them, who would rescue them. So the idea of loneliness also needs to be looked at where, you know, how would you represent it? Is it always about finding a cure? Is it always about finding a savior? Or is that loneliness something more? Is it also related to somebody's body? How one looks at oneself? How the people around you would look at you? So this idea of looked atness leading to that kind of loneliness, I think it's a, one can explore, you know, how all these different ideas add up to loneliness of a character. I think Karishma, we can discuss it over chat or maybe email, and that's it for today. I think I have tried to answer and talk to each one of you who have raised your hands. Thank you so much for joining us for today, and thank you so much, Anu. Thank you so much, Dave, for being so kind. And we are almost past 20 minutes to 8. I'm sorry for that. And we'll see you tomorrow at 6 for the last session of this 6-day workshop. Thank you so much.